Well, we're studying the first church. It's our 15th week in the first church. Acts 2, 42 to 43. Let's read that again, please. Acts 2, 42 to 43. Speaking to the first church. In the 41st verse, it says, "So then those who had received his word were baptized. And that day there were added about 3,000 souls. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles." Amen? We have looked at the apostles' teaching. We've looked at fellowship. We've looked at breaking of bread. We've looked at prayer. We looked at a sense of awe that filled the church. And now we're looking at signs and wonders. Because I don't think it's too hard for us to look at the first century church and say, we are not the same church they were.
Right.
There are things that are missing. And so let's look at what God thought was important to list that the first century church walked in and compare it to how we're walking today. We have the same teaching that they had, although they did not. They had the apostles sitting there talking to them, but we have the written record of everything that they said there. We have fellowship that is different than what they had. Our fellowship is one of convenience rather than one of necessity. We need to have a fellowship of necessity with one another. We need to get to a point where we hurt when we're not together, when we long for the fellowship of one another, where this is not a convenience for us, but it is a part of the need to be a part of the family. We looked at the fire ants who will become a raft in water, and they will protect the queen on top, and those on the bottom will create air bubbles and breathe so that they do not drown. When they become fatigued, they go up to the top, and others come down and take their place. They have a fellowship of necessity, and that's what the Greek word refers to in our New Testament. We must have a necessity of the fellowship of the bond of Christ, the family of Christ. You may try and find it in organizations. You may try and find it in hobbies. You may try and find it in different activities and things like that. Some of us even try and find it in our kids and our family. But you can't replace the fellowship of God with activities. It's empty and it's hollow. The breaking of bread, we saw that was a ritualistic thing where they got together and they shared food with each other and they shared the scriptures with each other. It wasn't just an angel food cake party, but it was a party to know one another and to know God better. We don't do that as often as we should. Prayer, we talked about prayer. Their prayer was a part of their daily existence. We don't pray like they did. The sense of awe. Now church has become as definable, describable, and just about as boring a thing as you can make it. Unless you find that sense of awe. And we looked at ways that should draw us to the awe of a mighty, awesome God. And now we look at signs and wonders. We said that signs and wonders first occurs in Exodus 7:3. We'll not revisit that, but you can go back and see that. Exodus 7:3. In the Old Testament, we looked at verses and found out that there were two different words for signs and wonders. Signs is the word oath. Oath. It's an expected or an unexpected event that point to God. Things that we expect God to do and that we give him the glory for it. And we give him the honor for it, like waking up in the morning. The fact that the sun comes up. Those are expected, but they are signs that God is alive and God is in control. A lot of times, you know, we can stand and see the daybreak or the sunset and say, gosh, God did a good job, didn't he? Isn't that great? It should make us think of him. But so many things happen throughout the day that we do not see as signs of a present God. They did. We looked at verses in the Old Testament where we saw signs being used, the word oath. Again, we'll not revisit that. Then we saw the word mopheth, manifestation of God's power and supernatural activity. This is when God goes above and beyond and does the spectacular. The spectacular. This is the parting of the sea. This is the raising of the dead. This is the healing of the sick. This is water into wine. This is all of those things. We go, whoa, pretty cool. And we looked at verses in the Old Testament where mopheth was used and examples of that. In the New Testament, we said that the word is simeion. Simeion is miracles. miracles, just the word miracles. And it talks about showing divine authority, that God is in control. We looked at Luke, we looked at Acts, and John has it 28 times. John was a recorder of the miracles and talked about it a great deal in the miraculous. Today then, this is where we are today. We start today's study by looking at the word wonders in the New Testament. The word wonders is the Greek word pteros. And this is the word that we get the word terror from. The word pteros means terror. Now, does that mean that miracles are terrible things? No. It causes us to marvel and to awe. The healthy terror that God is so in control that we should not presume upon Him. We shouldn't assume that He's not going to do this or that He is going to do this. This ought to keep us on our toes. Terrorists ought to keep us on our toes. Whatever God is going to do ought to keep us on our toes. There was a great psychology experiment done by a guy by the name of Jean Cellier. Cellier took three groups of rats to test stress on the life of a human and on animals. So he was doing a stress test. Cellier took three groups of rats, and one group of rats he gave a very, very, very slow-acting poison. So it would take about a month for these mice to die from the poison they'd been given so that he could study the reaction of the body on the stress of poison, which is an external form of stress. Would you agree? External stress on the body. The second form of testing that he did was he took a group of rats and he gave them a very fast-acting cancer that would kill them in about a month's period of time. Now, what was that? The stressor was when the body turns against itself. One that is purely external but biological and medical. One that is internal and the body turning on itself. And the third group of rats, he put on a rocker panel, had loud music and flashing lights. And they never knew when the loud music and the flashing lights and the music and all this was going to break loose. 24/7 at any time, those little rats could be living their little life, and all of a sudden, just terror would hit them because everything would break loose. All of them died within a month.
Oh my. Wow.
All of them died within 4 weeks because stress can be a killer. Stress can be a killer, was his point, that stress can kill. And it doesn't matter whether or not it's poison, cancer, or honey, mom's coming to live with us. Purely external, okay? Now, I know that's a Mother's Day joke, but you got to go with it, okay? So anyway, maybe it's the neighbors from heck, who are always noisy and running their motorcycles at 3:00 in the morning. But those kind of stressors still have the same effect on our body. They still affect us in the same way, whether it be internal or external. But when God does something that makes us go, whoa. Yeah. He did the experiment a second time, and he did the poison, he did the cancer. But the third group of rats had a little red light come on 30 seconds before all heck was going to break loose. The little light came on, and then the rocker panel, then the lights, and then the music. Those rats lived a normal life and did not die. They didn't die because of the stress. Because they could live a normal life, and they knew when the stress was going to hit with a 30-second time signal and could prepare for it. Now, which group of rats do you think we live like on a daily basis? Anybody got a red light going on before all heck breaks loose in your life? Wouldn't you love a little red light to come on and say, in 30 seconds you're going to get a flat tire? 30 seconds your car is going to stop running. 30 seconds you're going to have cancer. 30 seconds. It'd be great if we had that kind of warning, isn't it? But folks, the fact is we don't. We don't have that kind of warning. But we have a God who is our bridge over troubled waters. We have our God who will take us through anything. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. So this kind of terror is a terror that lets us know that God is in control, and we go, whoa. Believing in the miraculous can actually reduce your stress because you can either worry about it or you can have faith about it.
Come on. That's
awesome. You can believe that He's in control or you can wonder where He's at and why He's hiding. You can believe that all things will work together for the good, or you can wonder, what have I got to do to make this right because God's sleeping? Amen? Come on, I'm reading your diary. I'm reading mine. I'm reading our letters. Let's go to Acts 2. And we'll see an example of this word at work when we look at verse 19. And I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke in those last days. You see, we don't have to worry about when the end comes. He will let us know.
Yes.
Because our hearts probably could not take what's going to come if we're not prepared for it. God will prepare you and will set you up for that in advance. Look at 22. Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know. You were there, you saw it, you experienced it. Dry up and get real. You were there. My question to you is, how many of you in this congregation today can say that you have seen the signs, the wonders, and the miracles of a loving God in your life?
Amen.
Now, I don't mean namby-pamby little things. I see God in the miracle of the sunrise. Okay, that's a sign, but that ain't a wonder.
Boy.
Let's not get all spiritualized over this. Let's get down, dirty, and muddy and say, I can point to a time when I needed God more than anything else in the world, and he broke all the rules, and he busted through. We have seen it. We have experienced it. We are in the middle of it. And then verse 43, which is one of our verses, we'll not reread it, but the signs and the wonders that are about to come. Look at 4, verse 30, Acts 4. While you extend your hand to heal, and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. Healing with a touch. Having the power of God come through a person and have healing happen. We've seen that in this church. We have experienced that firsthand in this church.
Yes, sir.
Look at 5:12. At the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were taking place among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's portico. This is the outer rim of the temple area that had the pillars all the way around. We've seen this in our pictures before. The entire temple area was rimmed by this covered porch area where they met and they taught, and where Jesus spent most of his time teaching in the Solomon's portico. But there, miracles were happening. Can you imagine people going up to pray, to go to church, and having miracles happen as they walk by? That gets your attention. Amen? It'll get your attention. Look at 6:8. And Stephen, full of grace and power, was performing great wonders and signs among the people. I wanted to put this verse in because up until now, it has emphasized the work of the apostles, the ones who were there from the beginning, the ones who were there from Jesus' baptism to Jesus' resurrection were considered the apostles. It was what they had to do when Judas hanged himself and Matthias was picked to be the next apostle. Then he had to be attested to that he had seen everything. So there are a lot of people who had been with Jesus the whole 3.5 years. That was a part of the job itself and the requirements that were put upon them at that time. Now, Paul came along later, and guess what? For 3 years, he was kept in the Arabian desert and was taught by Jesus in the desert.
Yes, yes.
And so he said, I may not have been there for the baptism, but I was there for the instruction. Jesus pulled me aside for 3 years in the desert, and I went one-on-one with the teacher. I believe that Jesus supernaturally manifested himself to Paul. I don't think this was a voice in a cloud. I think he sat with Christ.
Amen. Yes. Uh-huh.
Look at 7:36. 7:36 says, this man led them out, performing wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness for 40 years. Speaking of Moses. All of these things are the wonders, the miracles, the things that are beyond the natural, beyond the expected, and that God still performs them. God is unlimited. God is unfettered. God is unhindered. Our God is unstoppable. Our God is unrestrained.
Come on, yeah.
Our God is God.
He's God.
Or is he? Or is he? You see, the Bible was written during a time of what we call theism, a theistic world, where God was preeminent in the hearts and minds of everyone. You see, ancient man believed that God or gods created and ran the cosmos exclusively. Man was a created observer and participant, and miracles were expected. I mean, come on, they took their gods with them. And they sacrificed to them. Why? So that they would do what they needed to be done. They expected the miraculous. When God performed a miracle, they were grateful. When he didn't, they went, that's the breaks. He just didn't do it. Or maybe we're not pleasing him. Go find a virgin. Let's throw her in the volcano, see if that makes him happy. Be very sad today. I'm not sure we could find enough to sacrifice. But in our world today, because we are no longer living in a theistic society that looks at it that way. But I think this is why there are miracles in the jungles and in the missionary worlds that we don't have today, because they still live in a theistic world. They still live in a world where they please God and they're afraid of God and they respect and they honor God, and we don't. Because we live in what is called a modern, scientific, non-theistic world today. We live in a world that has an explanation for everything and a reason for everything that excludes God. God is non-existent, and the world can be described, defined, and understood through natural systems of order. Science has the answer, we're told. We were told during COVID to just follow the science. Now, I don't want to get controversial, you know me. Never one to pick a fight. But how come when the CDC says in their own literature that you are not safe unless you are a minimum of 10 feet away from one another, did the CDC then say 6 feet apart? The science said 10. But the political correctness said, you know why they picked 6? Because it's easier for people to eyeball than 10 feet. People can say, if I lay down, I'm that far away, and I'm 6 feet away, but they couldn't do that with 10 feet, so they changed the science to convenience. We didn't follow science. We followed political correctness. How come viruses cannot be killed with soap and water or with disinfectant? Bacteria can be, but viruses cannot be, and that is science. That is the science. That is the proven science. And yet we were told to wash our hands and use disinfectants like crazy. That ain't science. That's political correctness. And I'm not even going to get on to masks. What the CDC decided about masks, and then broke their own rules and made regulations and enslaved an entire world to a non-scientific standard. Science has rarely been right about anything. It was from those wonderful folks who gave you the Earth is flat. The scientists are the one who said that the sun revolves around the Earth. Now, I have a textbook. We have a textbook at NOC right now, which I had removed. I fought to have it removed, and it was a science book called Earth Science, because it said in its book, the science textbook of a college, that said that it was theologians who said that the sun revolved around the Earth, and that scientists proved it right. I gave them a 4-page download of the writings of the theologians at the day that used the Bible to say that the Earth revolved around the sun, because that's what the Bible says and refers to in the Psalms and in the Proverbs. And then I gave them the list of 20 scientists who said, no, the sun revolves around the Earth. Now you tell me who was right. nowhere was science at the time, and the book got taken out. Don't jump on theology when you ain't got the proof for it.
Come on.
When a man named Darwin begins a study, because he says in the first chapter of his book, which has now been removed, by the way, in later printings, but in first editions it says, "I am studying the science of the creation of the world and excluding the presence of God to show that the presence of God was not at hand in the creation of the world." And his friend said he did this because his little daughter Anna died of a fever and he never forgave God. Now, isn't that a scientific reason to go around and try and prove stuff? Folks, that's theology. That ain't science. And it's bad theology. Frank Zindler was the right-hand man of Madeline Murray O'Hara as a young man. He was her bodyguard and her friend. He followed her around and was her chauffeur. He was Madeline Murray O'Hara's right-hand man. Today, he's an atheist, an author. He's the editor of the American Atheist Magazine, which is the largest voice of atheism in the world. And he's the director of the American Atheist Press. Frank Zindler is famous for saying this many, many times. If there never was an Adam and Eve, there never was an original sin. If there was no original sin, there is therefore no need for salvation. And if there's no need for salvation, there's no need for a Savior. And I submit that puts Jesus in the historical or otherwise into the ranks of the unemployed. I think that evolution is absolutely the death knell of Christianity. And that's why your schools want to teach it.
Come on.
The monkey scopes trial was a struggle over a theistic world and a humanist world where man is in control. I'm telling you, the devil is not very creative. He is not very creative. God is a creator. Devilism is a mimicker. He is a copycat. But that doesn't mean that he's dumb. Just because he's creative doesn't mean he's stupid, and let's not pretend that he is. The serpent is wise. The Bible calls him the ruler of demons, the god of this age, the roaring lion, the evil one, the tempter. All of those have power. All of them have strength. Moms, I want to talk about kids today. And kids, I want you to pay attention and listen. I'm talking to kids. There are good old regular kids that go to school. They're just regular kids, and they're going to have all kinds of problems. They're going to be faced with different kinds of temptations, right? They're going to be tempted by alcohol. They're going to be tempted by drugs. They're going to be tempted by sex, by peer pressure. Some of them are going to fall into laziness. And some of them just don't think for themselves. Some of you are saying, that was me in high school. Yes, pretty much, Steve, that was me. Right? That's what it is to be a teenager. But guess what? This is when the devil gets busy.
Come on.
Because bright kids are not only faced with this, and every kid in this room is a bright kid, every one of you. We got bright kid, bright kid, bright kid, bright kid, bright kid. We got bright kids. Fill in this room. We don't have regular normal kids, do we?
No.
The kids that attend this church are a notch above. Well, guess what? Not only do they have to fight the things of the regular kids, but they have to fight something else. And guess who's behind it? These kids have to fight the doubt that can be spread by teachers. Remember, the devil said in the garden, "Hath God said?"
Come on.
And what did he say to Jesus in the temptation? If you will, you. If you are, let's spread a little doubt. He is still here to make Christian kids who have learned the Bible doubt it.
Yep.
In books that say theologians were the bad guys, not scientists, and they lie. But they spread doubt in kids' minds, and they say, well, maybe that preacher back there, Steve, he was cool, but he was stupid. He's just not unlearned. He's not learned. He's not educated. I'll go toe-to-toe with your teachers. But I'll use facts.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a lot of kids are going to be faced with pseudoscience like we've talked about. It sounds real good, but there's no basis for it. Why do you think they still call evolution a theory?
Exactly.
Come on.
Yeah, come on.
Because it's a pseudoscience with no fact behind it, period. Mm-hmm. How about pseudo-logic? Logic that sounds good. Just like Frank Zindler. If there's no Adam and Eve, then there's none of this, and there's none of that, then there's no need for this. Isn't that logical? How about philosophy? Folks, philosophy. I love to study philosophy. I read philosophy. But it is man's attempt to explain the world and why we do what we do without God. That's all philosophy is. People that get philosophy majors come out atheists. Because they have the answer for everything. Or they got no answers for anything. That's how all philosophy majors come out. Well, how about arrogance that comes up in our bright kids? Arrogant, haughty spirits. Got it all under control. Know-it-alls. Why? Because they have the science and the logic and the philosophy on their side. They've been built up so that they will not listen to their parents who have been there and done that because they don't understand. And arrogance always follows the devil. Pride goes before a fall. A proud and arrogant, haughty spirit, I despise, says the Lord. And then that leads us to insecurities. Bright kids who follow science come out of colleges some of the most insecure people in the world. Because they fight the fight of what they think they know and what they've been taught and learned. So our kids either face the regular temptations and our bright kids are doubled down on by the devil. It is up to us to make sure that they do not fall prey.
Yeah.
How many kids are raised in this church, get a job, and disappear? I'd rather them be broken in church. It is a temptation. Modern scientific non-theistic world. God is non-existent and the world can be described, defined, and understood through the natural systems of order is what we live in today. In a theistic world, God is chosen to restrict himself, and miracles are not a violation. These are the two theologies in our world today. We have two theologies. One says God has chosen to restrict himself, and when he does a miracle, it's when he breaks his own rules. You're not supposed to be able to walk on water, but Jesus did. So he let the rules be broken for a moment. But there's a newer thought around that I'm really getting comfortable with. Miracles are not a violation of God's rules for earth, but they're a part of his process. And for the most part, we have not because we ask not. Because in the jungle, miracles happen all the time. You come here and they don't happen very often. Why? They're asking for them and believing them. We're beyond that. We're more sophisticated than that. We don't have to rely on that. Because we're living in an atheistic world, among a non-theistic world. Now again, this church is having its mind changed. Well, I've been here. My mind is being changed. Your mind is being changed. We are seeing the miraculous happen more and more in this church.
Yes, sir.
And we're not doing silly things like they do on TV, evangelism and stuff like that. We're not going to extreme. We're just following the Lord.
Yes.
And we're living in a life of awe. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Because in our church we've seen, we have experienced, we have prayed for, and we have received answers.
Yes, no doubt.
We don't have to go anywhere else to look for it.
Uh-huh.
We just show up and we're kind of expecting it now.
Right here.
We know if we pray for something and God doesn't do it, there's a greater purpose.
Yes.
But it ain't because we didn't ask.
That's right.
It's not because we didn't pursue it and go after it. Now, how do we know whether or not it's God or the devil? Does it bring honor and glory to God? Or does it bring honor to the person?
Come on.
Does it bring honor? Do I get a TV ministry out of this? Do I take my coat off and sweep it across the crowd and everybody falls down?
Oh, no.
Or does it give glory to God? That's our dividing line. But I can't stop. I'm sorry, I'm 6 minutes long, but I can't stop without asking, well, then why then did they do it so much and not now? We'll talk about that next week. I got the answer up there, but we've run out of time, and I'm not going to keep you any longer. But I need to get to why then and not now. I will tell you next week why then and not now. And you will feel good about it, and you will feel settled about it, and it will bring you peace when you hear the answer.
Amen.
It'll bring you peace. And you'll go, yeah, that fits Scripture. That's really good. Don't you like it when answers fit Scripture like that?
Yes.
Well, let's stand together and let's pray.